Welcome. I'm Reverend Doug Shepherd from Central Lutheran Church in Moose Jaw. I'd like to welcome you to this Christmas remembrance. Thank you for being here. And thanks also to James Murdoch and all the staff here at Moose Jaw Funeral Home for bringing us together to make this possible. Thanks also to Jaden Tuplin for his expertise in videotaping and editing and making what I'm sure is going to be a wonderful time together. Now, a wee bit later on, we'll be joined by my good friend Janet Purdy of Moose Jaw Christian Counselling Services. She'll be along to give us some tips and some advice on how we can better deal with some of the things that might be confronting us at this Christmas season. This is a time when, with a lot of other folks, we can acknowledge the feelings we have at this Christmas time, the reasons for those feelings, and maybe we can present those feelings to God as we ask for help and the peace that only God can give. Soon, you know, we'll be experiencing the shortest day, and that means the longest night of the year. The longest night of the year, known to some as the long, dark night of the soul. Memories of past experiences and present difficulties can absolutely be overwhelming for some folks. While we're together at this time, we'll hear some music just for the Christmas season, and we'll recognize, of course, that this is not necessarily a season of comfort and joy for everyone. Let's begin with a short prayer. Please join me. Loving and gracious God, we look to you as we would look to a loving mother or loving father who wipes away our tears and makes all things better. We ask you to look with tenderness and affection on those who suffer pain and loss. Heal their grief, strengthen their faith. Help them to understand that all separations, however traumatic, are only temporary, and that together with you we'll all be young again and laugh again. We ask this through Jesus, your Son. Amen. I've chosen a couple of readings for today that are some of my favorites, my very favorites from the Bible, and I hope they're your favorites as well. The first one is attributed to the mighty King David. He led ancient Israel to be the superpower of its day. He joined the kingdoms of Judah and Israel into that superpower. He was a mighty warrior, and he was also a humble man of God, who knew that whatever happened, God was there with him. Please join me in offering the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Wonderful words from the 23rd Psalm. Now, a reading that we often hear on a day like this comes from the Gospel of St. John, and it's indeed one of my favorites. It gives hope beyond belief and assures us of God's unending love for us. This is from the Gospel of St. John, the 14th chapter, beginning at the first verse. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also.
In the bulb there is a flower, in the seed an apple tree, and cocoons a hidden promise, butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and
Hi, I'm Janet Purdy, and I work with the Moose Jaw Christian Counselling Center, and I'm just here today to talk with you a little bit about grief. We have heard over these past 8 to 9 months that these are unprecedented days in our history of Canada and of the world as we deal with the coronavirus pandemic. But I believe these unprecedented days may be even more so for you. More so because the mourning the death of a loved one is hard, and the coronavirus crisis makes it even more difficult. Life changed when your loved one died, and it changed in the midst of a world that looks dramatically different than what it did. Social distancing, stay-at-home orders, and limits on the size of in-person gatherings have changed the way family and friends can gather and grieve. So I want to begin by saying I am sorry. Sorry that you have lost someone you love, and sorry that you have to go through it during these pandemic days. In our time together, I want to come alongside of you in the midst of your grief and pray that it offers a moment of comfort. There is an account in Scripture of a man called Job. He lost everything. His livestock were taken. They were either killed or taken. His workers and all his children were killed, and he became physically sick. Three of his friends heard of the tragedy Job had suffered and went to comfort him. As they came to be with him, they saw that his suffering was too great for words. And this account shows us how important it is to have social support, to have people gather around when we are in the midst of grieving, and with the coronavirus, this has become even more challenging. Grieving, which can be a lonely process, may feel even lonelier due to the pandemic, for we may not have access to the physical support that we relied upon to help us in times of loss. Part of what contributes to making grieving challenging during these days is that the opportunity to have a traditional funeral or a time of gathering together to remember and celebrate that person's life looks very different during these pandemic days. Maybe you weren't able to have a funeral service, or maybe you chose to delay it, or maybe you were able to have a service, but it looked far different than what it would have prior to the COVID days. Having someone you love die is agonizing, and the opportunity to have people physically gather around and support you has become even a bit more challenging during these pandemic days. As well, your loss has occurred in the midst of a global health crisis that is tending to dominate everyone's thinking and lives. These things may possibly contribute to an even greater sense of aloneness in the midst of grief. Losing someone we love may feel like our heart is breaking, for death brings a separation from the one we have deeply loved and who loved, supported, and believed in us and helped to give us confidence to move through life. Someone who would have helped maneuver through these strange days. And thus, this loss and separation brings a brokenness, an agonizing of our hearts that is unlike any other. But there is another truth that cannot be overlooked, and that is, for those who love, time is eternal. You understand what that means. While death brings separation and loss, it cannot stop the love that was shared, a love that endures forever. And with all the agonizing emotions that grief brings rattling around inside us, here we are in this unique pandemic Christmas season. A season that, while being uncertain and stressful this year due to COVID restrictions, is still a time that offers joy, hope, and love. A time of celebrating Christ's birth and all that goes with Christmas, while also being a time of not knowing what Christmas is going to look like this year. This Christmas will be a new journey for you and your family, for your loved one has died and your heart is aching for them. Christmas, a reminder to us of better days when our loved one was here as compared to this day when they are not. Being separated from them is painful beyond words and is one of the most difficult and challenging experiences we will encounter in life. I would like to come alongside of you today and just talk a bit about grief and dealing with the Christmas season. One of the best things we can do for ourselves and those close to us is to allow ourselves to grieve, and grieving involves our hearts. It is something that we feel and experience deep within our being. When we lose someone we love, we feel like a part of us is missing because there is an ache that enters our hearts from not being able to share that love with them anymore. Losing someone we love is like a wound that needs time and attention to heal. Oftentimes, the reality of losing a loved one does not hit all at once. You may be in the midst of feeling numb, and numb in the sense that you can hardly believe what has happened. You know what has happened, but it hasn't quite reached you yet. It's like there's a sort of an invisible blanket between the world and yourself. So give yourself and those around you permission to grieve what has been lost from your life. For grief invites us to remember, not to forget. Also know that your grief may have the same sensation as that of being afraid. The fluttering of the stomach and the restlessness may be experienced with both fear and grief. Also, give yourself time. It usually takes longer than most expect to work through the grieving process. Don't put a time limit on your grief. I heard how one widow described this time element as though you have arthritis, something that is very painful, and at first you don't know how you are going to cope with it. And it's something that doesn't go away. The pain is distracting and hard to do life with it, but eventually you learn to manage the pain and you learn to do life around it, even though the pain is still there. And grieving is a journey. It's not something that you get over, but it is rather something that becomes a part of you. A mother wrote a letter to Dear Abby, and she described it profoundly. My beautiful 20-year-old daughter was killed in a car accident. I am writing this to all the wonderful people who asked, "What can I do for you?" At the time, there wasn't much anyone could do to help, but after 2 years, I have an answer. Accept me for who I am now. When she came into my life, it changed me profoundly. Losing her did the same. Her father and I worked hard to honor her memory, but we will never get over it to the degree of being who we were before. I am different now. In some ways, I think better. I am kinder, more patient, more appreciative of small things, but I am not as outgoing nor as quick to laugh. I know people mean well when they encourage me to get on with my life, but this is my life. My priorities have changed. My expectations of what my future will hold have changed. Please extend to me again the offer of anything I can do, and please accept me as I am now. Try not to compare your loss to someone else's, for each one's grief is different. Also, during these pandemic days when the world seems turned upside down, you might not experience grief the same way you might have under different circumstances. Try to remember that grief is personal and everyone experiences it differently. Be kind to yourself. Please know that it also takes longer than one expects to work through the grieving process. It is not something that has a specific time limit. There will be times when we experience our grief much more intensely than at other times. These grief moments can come without warning and something that we cannot predict. What is a grief moment? It's a moment of being reminded that the one we love is missing from our lives. And they may be triggered by hearing a favorite song, coming across a card or a gift that you received from the person, or it may be triggered for no apparent reason. A quote I came across describes it well. Grief is like the ocean that comes and goes in waves. Sometimes you have a good idea how strong it will be because you can see it coming from a distance. Other times you have no idea that one's coming and it can knock the wind out of you. For many, the intensity of grief is experienced months following the death rather than soon after. This may be because the numbness is gone and now you are dealing with the reality that the loved one is not a living part of your life. Life is going on around you, but you may be feeling like you don't know how to live life without your loved one. Grief also expresses itself in just many different ways and emotions. There isn't one right way to feel, and there are many ways you may feel. Maybe you feel sad that you lost someone you love, that you won't have more of the days and moments and conversations with them that you hoped for. You feel sad for your loss and the loss of that person for your kids and your family. You may feel sad because you have lost the one you would remember life's moments with. Maybe you feel relieved that your loved one's pain has ended. Maybe you feel relieved because now you are not living in this place of limbo, knowing what's coming, but also a sort of not knowing how and exactly when that moment is going to unfold or how your life is going to be once the one you love is actually gone from your physical world. You may feel joy, that you had the joy and privilege of living life with this one you loved, that you knew the joy of loving them and of being loved by them. Joy in the moments you shared together and in the memories you like to remember. You feel angry or frustrated or confused that you have to live out this hard life circumstance, and you so wish you could find some way to make it go away. You may feel guilty for the things you didn't do or words you wished would have been spoken or maybe not spoken, goodbyes you wished you had the opportunity to say, or maybe guilt over thoughts or feelings you had during the illness, or about the person that you wish you never had. You feel afraid or anxious of what life will look like now. You might feel strong because in certain moments you realize that you are managing life. You are doing what you thought you wouldn't be able to do or wouldn't know how to do. You might feel depressed because this isn't how you had pictured your life and you're struggling to see a new good picture of what life could be without this one that you loved. You yearn for the one you love to be a living part of your life again, to not feel this overwhelming sadness. You feel exactly whatever it is that you might feel in that moment. You greet it, embrace it, and let it speak to you. And moment by moment, you will make it through. It's also important to find a way to express your thoughts and feelings. These pandemic days may contribute to a greater sense of isolation and may make it even more challenging and scarier to be aware of those feelings rattling around inside you. Having people mourn with you may help you to be more aware of those feelings. try to find a way to give words to the grief and sorrow that is a part of you. Maybe by talking with someone, and we can do that through phone calls, FaceTime, Zoom, or Skype, or even through journaling. It is good and healing to talk about the relationship you shared over and over again with those close to you. It may help you to come to a better acceptance of losing the one you loved. Grieving is hard work, and grieving during the Christmas season can be particularly difficult, for this season can magnify your feelings of loss. And I also think that during this pandemic Christmas season may even magnify it more. Typically, Christmas brings an expectation that it should be wonderful and special time for family and friends to be together. But this pandemic Christmas, there's a lot of unknowns in what that will look like. And then you add to that uncertainty your grief and the possibility that the last thing you may be feeling like doing is celebrating Christmas at all. As much as is possible during these pandemic days, it may be helpful to have a plan in advance in how Christmas will look for you this year. As you make your plan, try to keep some of these things in mind. Please don't try to avoid the season and what you are feeling, but rather embrace it. And this Christmas season, do what is comfortable for you within the health guidelines. Try to reduce the pressure. At the best of times, Christmas often comes with a sense of pressure. Baking, shopping, wrapping those selected gifts for loved ones, Christmas activities, although with this year, I don't think that will be happening too much. But just the preparation and the anticipation of it. And so just help to reduce the pressure. Ask yourself two questions. What do I want to do? And how much can I do? Look at what you should do and compare it to what you feel able to do, and find an acceptable compromise in the middle. We all have Christmas traditions, but you may need to go back to those two questions and just to ask yourself how you want to handle traditions this year for this Christmas season. What are you able to do, and what do you feel like you should do? Also, you may want to consider developing new traditions. You may wrestle with a sense of disrespect to your loved one if the tradition is changed. There isn't a right or wrong here. It's okay to keep traditions of years past, and it's okay to develop new ones. It's common to experience sadness and loneliness following the loss of a loved one, and want our friends and family to come alongside in the midst of it. And sadly, this may not happen in the same way because of the necessity of COVID guidelines. Because of this, you may need to be far more intentional in staying connected to others. And this may be hard and challenging, for your motivation to do things may be low, and you may not feel like talking to others after losing the one that you loved. You may need to be the one to arrange phone calls or somehow meeting together virtually. Arrange these conversations as appointments you must keep. You may need to be the one to break the ice, so to speak, and talk about your loved one rather than waiting for other people to do so. Resist the feeling of wanting to isolate yourself even more than what we are already experiencing during the pandemic. Nurture your need for continued contact with family and friends within the health guidelines. Also, relive the memories. When you turn your grief into remembrance, you are magnifying the life of the one you lost and allowing other people to get to know them in some way. Do take time to remember and share those special memories you have of your loved one. Talk about them even though the tears may flow in the midst. Know that what we miss the most is the exchanging of love with the person we have lost. Try to find a way to express that love. Light a candle at the dinner table, place flowers at the graveside, write a letter to your loved one. Give a gift to someone who might not have otherwise received a gift. Make a donation in memory of them, or sponsor a child with the same birth date. Also, celebrate what you have as a way of journeying through the loss of your loved one. Take time to enjoy something or someone in the present. The frost upon the trees, the love of another family member or friend. Treasure the truth that life truly is a gift. The loss of your loved one has changed you. While it is agonizing beyond words, it has also taught you more about life, more about what really matters in life, and that life is a gift and that relationships are what matter. Share what you have learned with others so that others can learn what really is important, what matters in life, and not to let life pass them by. In closing, while this Christmas may be filled with heartache and uncertainty as you journey through the loss of your loved one during these pandemic days, may it also be a reminder of the comfort, strength, peace, and hope that we can find in Christ. Christmas, a celebration of Christ's birth, a celebration of the truth that He is Emmanuel, God with us. God with us, what does that mean? There's an account in Scripture shared with us of when Jesus felt deep sorrow and wept in learning that his close friend Lazarus had died. A writer put it like this: because Jesus loved this family, he wept. And he weeps with us as well. Jesus still gets down in the middle of our sorrow and holds us close, mingling his tears with our own. I do pray that as you journey through this Christmas season and the many seasons to come without your loved one, that you would know that Jesus wants to hold you close, that he knows and cares so deeply that your heart is hurting, that his tears become mingled with your own. May the image of Jesus's tears mingling with yours be a source of comfort, strength, and peace in the days ahead. And now, I would like to light this candle of remembrance for the loved ones you have lost.
This is the candle of hope. And as we light this candle, let's pause to remember those we've lost over the past while. We pause to remember their names, their faces, their laughs, their voices. We give thanks. We give thanks for the memory that binds them to us at this time so close to Christmas. We pray saying, "Hear us, Lord," and I invite you to respond, "Your mercy is great." May the light of Christ redeem the pain of loss, the loss of relationships, the loss of jobs, the loss of health. As we gather up the pain of the past, we offer it to you, O God, asking that you will place in our hands, in our hearts, the gift of peace and the gift of life. Hear us, O Lord, your mercy is great. We remember ourselves at this Christmas time. We pause and remember the past weeks, the past months, and for some of us, years of downtimes. We remember the poignancy of the memories, the grief and the sadness, the hurt and the pain, as we reflect on our own mortality. Hear us, O Lord. Your mercy is great. We remember our faith and the gift of hope that God offers to us throughout the Christmas story. We remember that God, who shares our life, promises us a place and a time of no more pain and no more suffering. Hear us, O Lord. Your mercy is great. Let us remember the one who shows us the way and who goes with us into all tomorrows.
My way groweth drear. Precious Lord, linger near when my life is almost gone. Hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my work is all done and my race here is run, let me see by the light thou hast shone that fair city so bright, where the Lamb is the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me on. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I'm weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
In the spirit of the Christmas season, we ask God for help at this time as we cope with the loss, pain, suffering, loneliness, sadness, and grief. In response to the words, loving God, hear our prayer, please respond, and in your merciful love, answer. God, we come to you in this Christmas season as your children in pain. As the nights have been growing longer, so has the darkness wrapped itself around our hearts. In this season of the longest nights, we offer to you our pain in our hearts, the traumas that some of us just can't put into words. Loving God, hear our prayer, and in your merciful love, answer. Compassionate God, there are those among us who are grieving at what might have been. A death or a loss has changed our experience of Christmas. Once it was a special day for us too, but we've lost someone dear to us. We find ourselves alone, adrift, lost. Loving God, hear our prayer, and in your merciful love, answer. The Christmas season reminds us of all that used to be and cannot be anymore. The memories of what was, the fears of what may be, can stifle us. All around us, we hear the sounds of celebration, but all we experience is a sense of sadness. Please be near us. Loving God, hear our prayer. Lord, we ask you to be with those of us who mourn. Give us the strength, give us the courage to continue our journey until we rest in your kingdom with you and all who have gone before. Amen. With longing for the coming of God's kingdom, let's offer the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us. Together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us now remember those whom we've lost, but who remain in our hearts and souls. In the rising of the sun and in its going down, we remember them. In the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, we remember them. In the opening of buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember them. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of summer, we remember them. In the rustling of the leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember them. In the beginning of the year and when it ends, we will remember them. When we are weary and in need of strength, we will remember them. When we are lost and sick at heart, we remember them. When we have joys we yearn to share, we remember them. So long as we live, they too shall live, for they are part of us as we remember them. Well, friends, our time is almost up. I'd like to leave you with one final thought from a fellow by the name of Henry Scott Holland. He was a professor of divinity at Oxford University. He left us, he died on St. Patrick's Day, 1918, and he was only 71 years old. Here's what he says. Death is nothing at all. It doesn't count. I have only stepped away into the next room. Nothing has happened. Everything remains exactly as it was. I am I, and you are you. And the old life we lived so fondly together is untouched, unchanged. Whatever we were to each other, we still are. Call me by the old familiar name. Speak to me in a way that you always used to. Put no difference in your tone, wear no forced air of solemnity or sorrow. Laugh as we always laughed at the little jokes that we enjoyed together. Play, smile, think of me, pray for me. Let my name ever be the household word that it always was. Let it be spoken without effort, without the ghost of a shadow upon it. Life means all that it ever meant. It's the same as it ever was. There is absolute and unbroken continuity. What is this death but a negligible accident? Why should I be out of mind simply because I'm out of sight? I'm waiting for you, for an interval somewhere very near, just around the corner. All is well. Some wonderful words from Henry Scott Holland. Please receive a blessing. Let us go on our journeys proclaiming that we have seen the glory of God, believing that there is a light that shines in the darkness that the darkness cannot overcome. And may the love of the Creator, the joy of the Spirit, and the peace of the Christ child be with you this Christmas and forever. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another. Thanks be to God. Happy Christmas, everyone, and God bless.